Good evening and welcome to the Boneyard, Dallas, Georgia, where the defending state champion Langston Hughes Panthers travel to visit their region foe, the East Paulding Raiders. For Langston Hughes, they're 4-2 this year. That's two more games than they lost all of last season. They have been hit hard by injury, but beginning to slowly get healthier. And one thing they've had all year long is the number four quarterback in the country, the senior Prentice Air Nolan, who is poised to pass 1,000 yards for this season tonight. And the Hughes Panthers, although they rely heavily on their rushing game, averaging nearly 200 yards per game, they've got quite the weapon offensively in Air Nolan. Meanwhile, for East Paulding, after a dismal 3-7 season a year ago, they are 4-2 this year and 3-0 in Region 5 play in Class 6A. So Hughes, who is 2-1 in region play, has a chance to deal East Paulding their first region loss of the season and win the tiebreaker head-to-head as we enter the second half of region play. On to kick it away, Landon Schaefer for East Paulding as the Raiders won the toss and deferred. So Hughes will begin with the football. And it's an onside attempt. How about that? Playing aggressively, and it's recovered by Hughes. Well, didn't see that coming, but he's Paulding a heavy underdog tonight, despite the fact that they're the ones with the better region record. Trying to steal a possession here against Hughes. So here comes Prentice Nolan, Aaron Nolan. Quarterback wearing number one, Justice Savage. Is his receiver split to the left? We've got, or I should say running back to his left. First down and 10 from midfield as Nolan sets a man in motion. Puts it in the belly of Savage, who goes right in, wiggling forward into plus territory, and he's wrestled down at the 45-yard line. Tackle made by Josiah Marsh. Hughes put off a huge win over Carrollton in week one of the season, a game that was televised on ESPN, given the high profile of both quarterbacks, Juju Lewis for Carrollton and Aaron Nolan for Hughes. It's second down and 5 at the 45, and again they go to Hughes. He bounces outside, cuts back in, and he is met by a wall of Raiders. We'll see where they mark his forward progress, but South Paulding has earned a third down opportunity to try and get off the field. It's a gain of one. It's third down and 4. Two receivers spit to the field side. Nolan gives it to Savage again. He goes straight ahead, and he is short of the line of gain. A big wall that time from the defensive line. That's Kawan Donald, along with Caleb Funches. And don't forget Chris Stokes as well, the Marshall commit. And I figure if you're going to run the ball at the gut on 3rd and 4, you better really go for it on 4th and 2, and that's exactly what Hughes plans to do. Jones and Dejon John lined up left, and Justice Savage splits through the seam. He's inside the 10-yard line and taken down. What a burst of speed from Justice Savage. On 4th and 2, he picks up 37 yards as he found a crease and hit it like lightning. 1st and goal, Hughes. Ball spotted at the 6-yard line, rather. Savage again, up the middle. And he's taken down at the 1. Every play on this drive has been the handoff to Justice Savage, who had just 5 carries last week against Alexander. 90 yards, scored a touchdown. And a 56-0 route. 2nd and goal from the 1. They give it up the gut again. Is he in? Looks like they're going to mark him short. Yeah. Third and goal. This ball will be spotted inside the 1 yard line on the right hash. And you look at that Hughes line, their two tackles, a couple of SEC caliber players. Dontrell Glover committed to Alabama at left tackle. Right tackle Tavares Dice got offers all over the place. Handoff up the middle, and he's in for six. Savage gets Hughes on the board. 7 plays, 7 rushes, 50 yards, all for Justice Savage. And that'll be a point after attempt. And this will be taken by Ezekiel Cheers. Place kicker went 6 for 7 at point afters last week, his first attempts of the year. High snap, and Cheers punches it through. So with 9 minutes and 21 seconds left in the first quarter, Langston Hughes gets the short field after East Paulding tries to recover an onside kick to begin the ball game. And they give it to Justice Savage, and he ravages the Raider defense. These two teams in the same region for the second time this year. Or I should say for the second year in a row, rather. Last year they played for the first time ever in these two programs' history. Langston Hughes came out with the win down in Fairburn, Georgia, by a final score of 59-0. But this is a very different team than it was a year ago. East Paulding last year went 3-7. They won just one region game. And now they have a chance to field this kick. It'll be taken just inside the 25-yard line. Racing up the left side, this is Gil Kruma, and he is slammed to the ground at the 40. Tackle made. By Antonio Sledge. We've got our first flag tonight. It's going to be holding against East Paulding, our official tonight. Trevor Gonzalez, in his 9th year of officiating high school football here in the state of Georgia. So first and 10 in at quarterback for East Paulding. That would be Chance Booknight, the junior who played one of the best games of his career last week. And a little bit of a reverse. And it's a halfback pass. Looking for Booknight and just overthrowing him, Cameron Shelley. They've run that play once this year. Shelley connected for an 83-yard touchdown pass. You can tell right now East Paulding is playing this game as if they are a heavy underdog, taking some risks, trying to hit some home run plays. It's second down and 10. Twin receivers on both sides. And Javen Parker, their star running back, tries to go off right tackle, and he is swallowed up. He'll pick up a couple of yards. And at the head of that tackle appeared to be Jordan Thompson. Well, Parker's rushed for over 650 yards this year. He cleared the 1,000-yard mark last year as a sophomore. Last week against Noonan, he had 148 yards gained along with a couple of touchdowns. It's third down and 8. All spotted at the 27-yard line. Got to get to just shy of the 35. Booknight drops back 3 steps. Thrash over the middle. Caught by Nkrumah. And he's lined to break a tackle. It's Antonio Jones hanging on for dear life at that free safety spot. Gil Nkrumah had zero touches the last two games. That's his sixth catch of the year, and it's a big one. Gain of 22 yards, first and 10 at the East Paulding 49. Huge completion from Booknight. They go Parker. Wiggles past the edge rusher, but again, plugging the hole that time. Jordan Thompson with the help of Amir Glenn. Amir Glenn, 56 and white. He's a Wake Forest commitment. Third on the team in tackles, Jordan Thompson. 6 and white for Hughes. He leads the team with over 60 tackles. He's got at least 9 tackles in every game this year. So no gain on the play. Second down and 10. And they send a receiver in motion. That's Cameron Jones. He lines up as the H-back, and we got whistles, a pre-snap violation. Looks like a false start. Is going to go against East Paulding. So back up. East Paulding 5 yards. Cannot stress how improved this Raider team is from where they were a year ago. Second year under head coach Chris Hirschfield. Same formation, second down and 15. A little lob pass, complete to Jones. He redirects upfield, juts back inside, and he's taken down at the knees just outside the hashes there. He gets back to the original line of scrimmage. Xavier Leonard making the stop for Hughes. Again, those two linebackers, Thompson and Leonard, they're the heartbeat of this defense. What is your traditional 4-2-5. Third down and 10. Got to get to the Hughes 41. Booknight with time. Scrambles. Takes off left. And he's right near the line to gain. He falls forward and picks it up. Chance Booknight. Ankle tackled, I believe, by Quay Pitts. He needed 10. He got 11. Opening drive for East Paulding. They began this game with an onside kick. It was recovered by the Hughes Panthers. And they went 50 yards on 7 carries, all by their running back, Justice Savage, for an early 7 points. Shelley in motion again. Pause, then starts back up. Booknight surveying, rolling right. He's running out of time, and he lobs it high in the air, and it's intercepted. Picked off. Racing down the sideline, Jacob Goody hurdles Booknight, the only man left in his way. And Jacob Goode, with his second interception of the season, flips the field big time on East Paulding. That was close to a 40-yard return from Goode. And it's first and 10 Hughes. Now midway through this first quarter, Hughes Panthers getting healthier by the week, it seems. They were just clobbered by injuries around early September, especially to their receiving corps. But they return Giovanni McGee tonight, wearing number 2. He's got a 4 wide receiver set. And then running back is Trey Page, and the flag comes out with the snap. It'll be a false start against Hughes, so that'll back him up to the East Paulding 30. We saw Justice Savage, all 7 carries in that 7-play 50-yard drive, 21. Now they brought in Dorian Trey Page, who actually leads, at least before we began play tonight, Hughes in rushing entering tonight. He's got close to 600 yards. He's at the left hip of Aaron Olin, number 4 quarterback in the country. The southpaw lets it fly a long way down, a dangerous throw, but it's complete. That is caught by Giovanni McGee. That's his first catch this year that hasn't gone for a touchdown. He had 2 touchdown catches against Carrollton in week 1, but hadn't played since. Coach Williams called him the last piece of the puzzle, and Nolan had just enough zip on that ball. That's a long throw. Going to the field side, throwing it beyond the numbers. He got it just in time before the corner could jump the route. So it's a gain of 11, second down and 4 from the 19, and more movement up front. Another false start on Hughes. That's now 3 pre-snap penalties we've seen. 2 on the last 2 downs. thinking about the kicking game for the Panthers. They've got Kajon McLean. They feel like he can hit anything 30 or inside of that. He did hit one from 36 in practice this week. So Breece Paulding, it's not a given. If he can knock Hughes back, then the Panthers will get points on this drive after the turnover. Interception, a long return from Jacob Goode. So second down and 9. Got to get to the Raider 15. Hughes, play action, throw over the middle. It's off the right hand of McGee. Can't haul it in. That'll bring up third down. He was open. Looked like Jameel Jones, the corner for the Raiders. The junior had given quite the cushion to McGee. So third down at 9. Trips left to the field side. Page around the right side. He tries to spin out of a tackle, but he's met by a couple other Raiders. It's going to be a modest gain of maybe a couple.
Tackle by number 94, Chris.
Big tackle from Chris Stokes, senior, 6'5". That brings up fourth down. Ball is spotted at the 23-yard line, so it's a short 8. Haven't seen Hughes go to the air much. Might be forced to here as Nolan drops back. He sends it towards the 10-yard line and wide open on the out route. It is hauled in by McGee. You can just see how much Hughes must have missed McGee. A couple of huge catches already on this drive, and it'll be first and goal just inside the 10. Pick up a 13 on that catch. Nolan hands it off to Page. He lowers the boom and down to the 7-yard line. Brody Burge, the junior linebacker, is laying the first lick on Page. Second down and goal from the 7. Using a bunch formation tight to the line here. Nolan directs Page to go to his left side. And they run the play strong side. Page looking for a hole. He's got absolutely nothing. Enveloped by the Raiders on the boundary side. And that was Jamarco Ford from his star position. He was the first point of contact against Page. Third and goal at the 5. Hughes already up 7-0. Both of their possessions have begun at midfield or better. It was not failed onside kick to begin the game, and the interception return from Goode that got up to the 25. Nolan throws it up, jump ball back in the end zone, and it is incomplete. Intended for McGee.
Brings up fourth down.
I believe that was Jeremy Leader on the coverage. He is the leader, quite literally, of this Raider defense. And Coach Hirschfield telling me, I know it seems a little bit on the nose, but he really is the heart and soul from a personality and a vocal standpoint. Huge play in this one. Fourth and goal from the 5. Nolan rolls left. Survey back at the end zone. He overthrows his target. Turnover on downs. He was eyeing Jabari Jones. Might have had a slight window, but it would have taken a perfect throw. Pretty good coverage as well by Jameel Jones. That's a huge stamp for East Paulding. You know, we spoke to Coach Williams Hughes, and he told us the key, really, aside from being healthy, is just for his team to focus on being themselves. His message this week was, the only team that can beat us is Hughes, ourselves. If we play our game, nobody can beat us. And, you know, there's some truth to that. Hughes, of course, lost in the state finals 2 years ago in heartbreaking fashion against Buford, and then won their first ever state championship against Gainesville last year. So first and 10 inside the 5-yard line. They give it off to Javen Parker.
Parker on the field.
And he picks up a solid 6-7 yards. Javen Parker last year rushed for over 1,000 yards, had just one 100-yard game. He's already had four games over the century mark this year. In fact, in that track meet against Hiram, a 52-49 loss for the Raiders, he rushed for 188 yards. And again, they go left side. Another touch for Parker. Big Frederick Tigner getting over there. Running him down, but it's enough to pick up the first down. Kind of about four. First and 10 at the Raiders 16. Under 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. A deep shot. One-on-one coverage. Booknight sends it high over the heads of Brian Allen. He was going toe-to-toe there with Zach Hill. And Hill was really the only one who might have had a shot at it. See some of these deep shots, these aggressive plays taken by the Raiders. Coach Hirschfield told us they got to pick their spots for their deep shots. Not 100% convinced that they feel they can drive the length of the field against this vaunted big defense. Parker wiggling up the middle, gets to the first level, and he's bumped to the ground by Santonio Jones. He didn't wrap up. He's bodied. Another first down. This time the ball spotted at the 28. Gain of 11 or so. Booknight. Look at the wheel route. It's not there. He's under duress, and he's taken down behind the line of scrimmage. A sack for Langston Hughes. Fred Tigner was the man in the area. And now it brings up second down and long. It's a loss of 7 on the sack. Under a minute to play here in the first quarter. The field is slick. We had a lot of drizzle the last couple of hours. It cleared up about half an hour before game time. Make no mistake, the field is wet. Play action. Booknight complete on the slant route to Cameron Shelley, his first touch. And he's sandwiched just shy of the 35-yard line. That tackle made by Santonio Jones. 3-year starter, he's only a junior. Keep in mind, those first 2 years, both ended at Center Park Stadium in the state finals. He was starting for both those teams. So it's third down and 5. 12 seconds left in the quarter. I think Coach Hirschfield wants to know if he can run this out. Play clock looks like, yep, he can. He can run this out if he wants. About a 3-second differential. That's exactly what they're going to do. That's going to be the end of the first quarter. Langston Hughes gets inside East Paulding 10-yard line. Goal to go. They get in once, but they are stonewalled the second time and turn it over on downs. And so after 12 minutes of play, it's the number 7 Hughes Panthers leading East Paulding Raiders 7-0.
In Cartersville Bartow, 3 Smithsonian-affiliated museums, Barnsley Resort, and an authentic downtown full of unique restaurants and shops. The perfect destination for a memorable staycation, only in Cartersville Bartow.
Cigna Healthcare is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna Healthcare's mission is to improve the health and vitality of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is all about Georgians standing together for substance misuse prevention. Be kind to your mind. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
While we've got a quick break in the action, did you know that the same area of just one football field can contain up to 95 termite colonies? That's why you need Breda Pest Management to defend your home. Breda, the official pest control of high school football.
Got to have a two-back system on the Panther side of things. You've got Justice Savage and Trey Page, but East Paulding, they're not shy about it. 90% of their rushes are to number seven, Javen Parker. So first and 10, ball at the 44-yard line. Play action. Booknight rolls to the right. Nobody open deep, so he'll turn upfield and scramble. Look at that lightning racing down the sideline. He's beating everybody. 15. Touchdown scamper from Booknight, and now an extra point away from tying this thing up. He is electric, and that's and Schaefer's extra point for the uprights. And good. Like a rock. So 7-7. 11 minutes and 15 seconds left in the first half. Chance Booknight and Baylor Thomason have pretty much split duties at the quarterback position since Coach Chris Hirschfield arrived here last season. Last week, it was only Booknight in at quarterback. Coach Hirschfield told us it's really because he's beginning to play more intelligently, making better reads, and he's really coming into his own, and he's kind of taking the reins, at least so far tonight and last week at the quarterback position. By the way, his previous longest rush on the year was 23 yards. That one is 61-yard touchdown rush on a scramble from Chance Booknight. All right, so we saw Schaefer try for an onside the first time. Did he do anything tricky here? No, a little bit of a pooch kick. Be fielded by the up back at the 30-yard line, trying to go alongside, and look out, here we go. Before he is ridden down, inside the 35. Traquavius Brown that time, fielding that kick. And while Hughes will get it, at the 34-yard line, that's actually by far their worst field position to start a drive so far today. They've been at the 50-yard line and at the Raider 25. It's the first time they're starting their half of the field. 11 minutes flat left in the second quarter. First and 10 at the Hughes 34. The receiver in motion, that's Jabari Jones. The handoff goes to Justice Savage. And he's taken down, maybe for a loss. And that was Caden Russell wrangling him down and losing his helmet, so he'll sub out of the game. In comes Chris Stokes. Caden Russell, big number 99 for East Paulding. His father, Derek, the defensive coordinator. Brody Berg also comes out. It's Josiah Marsh checks in. H-back behind the left side of the line. Two receivers split out field side. Nolan over the middle, and it's complete! Racing down the center of the field! An absolute dart that time, and it was reeled in by Dejon Gibson.
Gibson on the reception, brought down by number 24.
He hasn't been one of Nolan's favorite targets this year, but man, that was a huge catch. He brings it all the way down to the 26-yard line. That's a 40-yard gain. Play action again. Back to Gibson, the hot hand. He tries to go down the sideline. gets out one tackle from behind before he's directed out of bounds.
Number 29 on the reception, Gibson.
It was Wayne Lucas on the tackle.
Wayne Lucas. Second down.
It's a gain of 8, second down and 2. All at the Raider 18 as Hughes is in the red zone for the third time tonight. Nolan looking left. Deep fade route. Bounces high in the air and then down to the ground. Jabari Jones was the man trying to make that catch for Hughes. Racing for the back pylon. There's enough air to that pass to where Jeremy Leader could race back. Run it down. It was also Jamil Jones back there. Third down and 2, ball at the 18. God, they're going to Savage here. This is likely four down territory, but they do give it to Savage. He scores through the right side. He's got the first down, tries to hurdle or jump something. And Wayne Lucas just kind of catches him in midair there at the 12-yard line. Pickup of 6. First and 10. The drizzle is back. Raining just a little bit here. Dallas, Georgia. Game time temperature is about 70 degrees. We're tied at 7. There's a 61-yard scramble for a touchdown from Chance Booknight Hughes on the march. Nolan, Savage, up the middle, and just shy of the goal line. Another gash from Justice Savage. Touchdown saving tackle. Corpus Martinez, senior linebacker, who's had a terrific senior year. And now Hughes trying to hurry up a little bit here. First and goal from the 1, down near the goal line, and he's in! Touchdown, Hughes! Delayed signal that time.
21.
But it's another touchdown for Justice Savage. Think he wears 21 just by coincidence? I don't think so. That's now 12 touchdowns on the season for Savage on the ground. Second one tonight. Point after attempt after the 66-yard drive. 1:50 off the clock. Ezekiel cheers. Jabari Jones the holder. High snap. Jones aborts. He's racing for the end zone, looking to throw it up. Hoists it high in the air, and it's too tall that time. He was looking for Alonzo Jackson. High snap that time. Jones tried to make something happen there, but it's going to be a 13-7 lead. Scores for East Paulding throughout the season.
Ladies and gentlemen, our cheerleaders will be collecting donations tonight to benefit.
If their team, or their opponent rather, scores 20 or more points,
they
have not won this year.
Also, we'd like to give
those two losses, 52-49 against Hireman, that North Paulding took them down 21-17. As an offense, they average 36 points a game. They put up some big numbers, but they haven't necessarily had a lot of success. They've been giving up a lot of points. And the kick is away, back pedaling and retrieved just at the 10-yard line. Now redirected up the middle, and there's some space. Finally, the tackle made right around midfield. And Jamarco Ford was on the return. It's going to be a 40-yard return for Marco Ford. First and 10 from midfield for East Paul. Book Knight hands it off. I think that was Eddie Ferguson there on the carry, not Parker.
Parker on the carry.
No, it was Parker. I'm making Parker. Javen Parker on the touch.
Good game on the play.
Amir Glenn got a good push against the center guard box that time. Now there's a receiver who's entered the field of play late. They're taking a shot deep. That's Jamon Harris. He hauls it in. Jamon Harris, he subbed into the field, and Hughes wasn't aware. He came off the sideline at the last moment, and Jamon Harris, just his third catch of the year, and that one goes for 35 yards. That is that big play that East Pawnee's been looking for, and they'll look for it more tonight. It's Parker, bouncing out right, inside the 10, tripped up at the 5, right near the first down marker. First and goal, under 8 minutes to play in the first half. Ball at the 5 for the Raiders. Book Knight to Parker again, and he bowls in the end zone. Touchdown, Raiders. We got ourselves a game here at the Boneyard. Three touchdowns already in the first 4-plus minutes of the second quarter. And now East Pawnee can take their first lead of the night with a successful extra point from Landon Schaefer. He is 24 for 25 on the year. That one miss was last week against Newton. And the kick is good. 14-13. East Paulding, who lost to Hughes 59-0 last year. This is a different game here tonight. It's a different Raider team. When Chris Hirschfield arrived here, he said last year all about the culture change. They lost just 4 seniors from that team a year ago. And one thing that stuck out to Coach Hirschfield was how this senior class, the class of 2023 here at East Paulding, has adopted his energy and his passion. They felt like they probably couldn't compete with Hughes' speed, but they felt like they could use their physicality as well as their passion to punch Hughes a little bit. Because unlike East Paulding, Langston Hughes lost a ton of seniors, or many seniors, off that state championship team from a year ago. Schaefer on for the kickoff. And it's another pooch kick fielded just inside the sideline. It's caught inbounds, they say. Terquavius Brown, and I tell you what, if he makes that catch with his foot out of bounds, that's a penalty against East Paulding. I think that's exactly what official Trevor Gonzalez is discussing right now with his referee. No flag has come out. No! Yes, it is a legal procedure. They're saying he was out of bounds when he caught the football. This should put the ball at the 40, I believe. I didn't see a flag come out, though. And now they're walking the ball up. Yes. That's going to be a penalty for kicking the ball out of bounds, and it'll be placed at the 35. So first and 10, not the 40, I beg your pardon. Ball spot at the 35. I'm not sure if Terquavius Brown knew he was doing that, but that was a really nice play, making the catch with his foot out of bounds. I'm going to say he didn't know what he was doing because he tried to run off with it. But course, the benefit of Hughes. Trailing for the first time tonight, down 14-13, 7:46 on the clock. It's been an off and on drizzle. It's off right now. Nolan up the middle. This is Trey Page. He is stood up and driven back. And a roar from Trayvon Harris, number 11 in black. Trayvon French up in the court. French, a late bloomer. Described by Coach Hirschfield, a senior, and standing 6'2" out there, just a touch under 200 pounds. Xavier Tiller, the tight end, motions out to the left side of the line. A couple of receivers in tight towards the boundary. Nolan fires field side near the sideline, and it's hauled in for a first down and more. Jabari Jones. Junior leads the team in receptions and receiving yards entering tonight. That catch will put him over 1,300 yards in his career. He has really stepped up for Hughes. We talked about how they've gotten healthier. They are still missing one of their top playmakers, LSU commit JoJo Stone. By that time, it's a pickup in the Raider territory. And a handoff. Page finds a burst in a hole. He's inside the 30, down to the 20, bowling over a defender, still on his feet, spins, and they will rule him out of bounds at the 11-yard line. 32-yard rush for Trey Page. Now they equate him kind of to the lightning to Justice Savage's thunder. He showcased it there. Under 7 minutes to play. First and 10 from the 11. To number 11. A flag comes flying out from the sideline. As Page is wrapped up by Caleb Funches. Let's see what the call is here. Looks like a legal procedure. Legal shift that time. Back him up to the 16, first and 15. Four drives for Hughes tonight. All four have gone into the red zone. Nolan barking out a high snap. And a delayed handoff. Did Nolan get rid of it? No, it looked like he was trying to give it off to Trey Page, but instead of risking the transfer, he just held on to it. As he was demolished by Caleb Funches. And that's one area where Chris Hirschfield really thought his Raider team could hang with Hughes. They've got some serious size in the defensive line, none bigger. And their nose tackle there in the middle, number 92, Kiwan Donald. He's 6'2", 375 pounds, and was just given his eligibility last week. This is just his second game of the season, so he's fresh, lined up right over the center, Jamal Gowans. Nolan down the right side, a perfect throw. Oh, but the receiver, McGee, could not get a foot in bounds. McGee pleading his case that time. We've just crossed over the midway point of this second quarter. So it's third down and 23 from the 24. Now, if you're Hughes, this is pretty clearly two down territory. By two receiver set. Page to Nolan's right. Drops back. Looking left. Rolling that way. He's got a ton of space. He's going to take it down and run. Inside the 10, down to the 5. And touchdown, Aaron Nolan. His first rushing touchdown of the season, as he saw a full acre available to the left. A 24-yard touchdown rush for Aaron Nolan. He had just 22 rush yards on the year. Of course, you can imagine sacks impact that as well, but man, Aaron Nolan, that wasn't on the scouting report. He takes it all the way into the end zone for 6. So Hughes back in front, 19-14. Looking to go for 2 here, make up that missed extra point. Nolan running right this time. This time he fires it, and it's just beyond the reach of Giovanni McGee. Ruled incomplete. That first pass he couldn't haul in. Maybe that was a pass that McGee could have caught and gotten his foot in. That one, I think he was just thrown too far beyond the end zone, where even if McGee had been perfect, I don't think there was any way for him to get that foot down. So 19-14. And Aaron Nolan. Gets Hughes back in front.
Our Raider football team would also like to thank Hardy Automotive Group.
We appreciate you joining us here, wherever you might be watching on YouTube, or a variety of other destinations, checking out our stream. We're excited to have the two top quarterbacks, senior quarterbacks in the state on the GPB airwaves tonight, Juju Lewis. Over at Carrollton, and Aaron Nolan here tonight, who, again, hasn't featured the rushing side of his game this season, but that's a pretty good showcase right there. 24-yard touchdown run. Hughes, 5 minutes, 44 left, second quarter. 26 points, 4 touchdowns scored in the 6-minute span. And this ball tumbling in over head, and it's bobbled and knocked backward. Who recovered it? It was in and out of the hands of Cameron Jones, and it looks like, is Hughes going to come up with a football? I don't see who walked away with it. Yeah, it's going to be Hughes football. There's some discussion as to if there is anything, maybe a penalty or a hit or maybe targeting, I don't know, but Justin Bonds recovers the fumbles, and right now it looks to be Langston Hughes football. And for the second time tonight, they begin a drive inside the Raiders' 40-yard line in plus territory. Ball's going to be spotted at the 32. That's the second turnover. Second turnover for East Paulding tonight. They were able to keep Hughes out of the end zone after that big interception return from Jacob Good. But a muff kickoff by Jones, recovered by Bonds, and Nolan dumps it off. Complete to the tight end, Xavier Till, trying to put the poops on the linebackers of East Paulding. They're having none of it. That play loses 4, maybe 5 yards.
Tackled by a host of Raiders. Brings up second down.
A loss of 5, ball at the 37. They get to the 22 for a second and 15. Over the middle, complete inside the 30. Off goes Gibson, makes a man miss, and he is into the end zone. 37-yard pitch and catch. That time it's Dejon Gibson. And just like that, it's a two-score game, 25-14. That is the third touchdown of the quarter for Hughes. It's also the first passing touchdown for Aaron Nolan tonight. 4.5 minutes left in the first half, and Hughes is spoiling homecoming. Direct snap, looking to go for two, and did Jabari Jones get in? He did. The two-point conversion is good from Jabari Jones. And now it's 27-14. Now it's gut check time for East Paulding. Coach Hirschfield told us this game wasn't going to be about trying to keep momentum away from Hughes. They're too talented, they're too good. It's about recapturing that momentum once it goes the Panthers' way. It is safe to say that after a touchdown to retake the lead on that scramble on third down at 24 from Aaron Nolan, and then a muffed kick, and then a two-play drive, which ended that Gibson touchdown, Panthers clearly have momentum right now. Deep return man at the 20. And this is caught cleanly this time by Eddie Ferguson, spinning forward out to about the 35-yard line, just shy. But that drizzle may be having a little bit of an effect here. I mean, you got to think about it, that muff kick from Cam Jones. So they will spot it right at the 35. A 10-yard return or so. 4 minutes, 25 seconds. Panthers leading the Raiders 27-14, but East Paulding, although they're down by two scores, they get the ball to begin the second half with a four-minute drive here to end the half. Another four-minute drive to start the second half, and they're right back in this thing. They give up the middle to Parker. Squirms through down near the 40 before he's taken down by Quay Pitts, number five in white. It's a pickup of five. Each team with all three timeouts. Chance Booknight with Parker to his left and a step behind. Lone receiver at the bottom is Kruma. They go to Parker again. And he bullies his way out to the 43-yard line. Pick up a three, third down and two.
Tackled by number 58, Montel Glover. Brings up third down.
Don't think East Paulding would like to have to make a decision on fourth down here, but it does feel like the game is hanging in the balance here. If Hughes scores again, it takes a three-score lead into the locker room. That'd be a serious problem for the Raiders. They give it to their most trusted back, Parker. He's met, I think, just shy of the line to gain. Or beg your pardon, that was a play fake. It was Booknight on the keeper. Are they going to give him the first or not? It was big Fred Tigner on the stop. And they will say he picked up two. Just barely got the two. First and 10, East Paulding. Clock winding towards the three-minute mark. Brian Allen, the lone receiver on the near side, lined up around the numbers. Cam Shelley split out far right. And Gil Nkrumah in the slot. Booknight drops. looking for Brian Allen, taking a deep shot, and it's just beyond the outstretched fingertips of Allen. Zach Hill in coverage, and he was right on top of him. Second down and 10, clock stops at 2:44. Defending state champions, the Hughes Panthers, looking to pick up their third region win of the season and get the tiebreaker over East Paulding, who currently sits at 3-0 in region play. Same formation. This time they give to Parker. He goes off right guard and lunges forward out to midfield. Pick up a 5. Third down now. Big third down play here. East Paulding trying to recover after their second turnover of the half led to a quick 8 points rather for Hughes. And tumbling forward out to the 42-yard line. It'll bring up fourth and short. Parker again on the carry and in plus territory, down by 2 scores with under 2 minutes remaining in the first half. The Raiders are going to go for it. No blitz shown yet, but just the 4 down linemen for Hughes. And now a little bit of confusion perhaps as Kruman motions out wide. Hirschfield looks like he's going to call a timeout, and he will, with 8 seconds left on the play clock. And he could have killed another 6 or 7 seconds, so that leads me to believe he is still going to go for it here, but maybe he didn't like the play call. Minute 38 on the clock, 27-14, Hughes leading East Paulding. We're here live at the Boneyard. Got the Black Hole fan base in the end zone. They really live up the Raider-like black and silver mantra here at East Paulding. And, you know, it was a team and a program that Coach Hirschfield was extremely optimistic about. Thought it could be something special, but he had a lot of work to do, perhaps more than he even realized when he took the job. He was the offensive coordinator at Walton High School for 5 seasons, and while they were in the Final Four, the East Paulding job opened up in early December. He reached out to Athletic Director Andy Dorsey, former head coach at Paulding County, told him, hey, I'm interested, wait for me. They did, got the interview, took the job. So 4th down and 2. Cam Jones pitches inside. They hand it off to Parker. He's through the first wave. He gets the first down and a whole lot more. Weaving inside the 20. Oh, look at him dance inside the 10-yard line. Javen Parker. First the burst. And second, the shifty and the swiveling action of those quick feet. Huge play from Parker, a gain of 32, a minute 30 on the clock. It's first and goal from the 10-yard line. And East Paulding has 2 timeouts. It's like Coach Hirschfield wants them to kill a little bit of clock here. And now they get rolling into their formation. It's going to Parker again. He hesitates and then moves forward for a gain of 2. Under a minute to play, the clock is winding. 2nd down and goal at the 8. He's Paulding trying to be delicate with this clock management. They don't want to give Aaron Nolan any time after they plan on scoring. 40 seconds. 2nd and goal from the 8. Booknight looking to pass, dancing around, throws it deep in the corner of the end zone. It is caught for a touchdown. What a throw! And Cam Shelley just dragging the toe. It's a touchdown for East Paulding. You want to talk about narrow windows? That was a dart from Chance Booknight. Delivered in the perfect place for Cam Shelley to make the catch. 8-yard touchdown pass, 32 seconds left. Schaefer on for the point after. And it is good. All righty. East Paulding, the only thing they could critique about that drive would be the 32 seconds they left on the clock. But, I mean, I tell you, when they started that drive, we said, okay, four-minute drive, get in the end zone, get to halftime down by six. Hit a four-minute drive afterwards, and then get back in it. Meanwhile, Hughes, again, they had all the momentum. They've had the big plays in this one so far, it feels like, especially in the turnover department. They've capitalized on that muff kick. Question now for Coach Williams, how aggressive will he be with these 32 seconds? Hughes 27, East Paulding 21. Shaver's got a big leg. He had a 54-yard field goal earlier this year. But they haven't wanted to kick it deep to Gibson and Trey Page. They've been dropping it right around the 25-yard line of the upbacks. How will they play this one? Another sky kick. And this one is taken at around the 25. And met immediately. Jamarco Ford making the tackle on Khalil Allen. 26 seconds left. This is, I think, the worst starting field position Hughes has had all night. They have all three timeouts. They don't have much of a kicking game. They really have to get inside the 15-yard line to think about a field goal, at which point they feel like they can normally get in the end zone. Well, they're not lined up in a victory formation here to take the lead in the half. See how aggressive Noland is. And he gives it off to Page. Bounces through two tackles, and now he's got the sideline. It's a foot race. Page dashing down into plus territory. Bumped out of bounds by Demarius Whitaker. And now a timeout called by Coach Williams at the 46-yard line. It'll be first and 10. It's a gain of 18 yards. Or big part, 28 yards.
Timeout taken by the Panthers. Technical timeout taken by the Panthers on the field.
So 18 seconds left. Hughes has hit on some big plays tonight. Most recently, that 24-yard rush from Aaron Nolan. Made it 19-14. And then it was a 37-yard pass from Nolan to Gibson that made it 27-14, along with the two-point conversion from Jabari Jones. So two timeouts left for Hughes. 18 seconds. Giovanni McGee is the lone receiver at the bottom. Trips to the field side. It's Dorian Page, the halfback, lined up at the right hip of the quarterback, Aaron Nolan, future Ohio State Buckeye, one of the top quarterbacks in the nation. Left-hander drops the pass. Fires it deep down the field. It's caught. Did that knee go down? I think it did. Either way, Jabari Jones is ridden down. It'll be second and one. Second timeout is called with 9.5 seconds left. So second timeout for Hughes. We know Aaron Nolan's got the arm strength to get into the end zone. And they've got a timeout, so the middle of the field is open so long as you don't use up all 9.5 seconds. East Paulding trying to get this game into the half, down by only a score. receivers are McGee and Jones. Also Dejon Gibson. And Xavier Tiller, the tight end, is split out. He's the innermost receiver of those three. He's got some pretty serious size. You could go to him for a jump ball. Nolan instead going to the left, caught quickly by Jones. He rushes out of bounds. 4.5 seconds left. They get it inside the 25-yard line. And this ought to be the final play of the first half. Boy, Hughes has done a masterful job of balancing the need to move forward and also preserve time. They've managed the field and the clock well. And they've earned themselves a shot here from the 24-yard line and a timeout called by Coach Hirschfield. It's really impressive work. David Hart, the offensive coordinator for Hughes, who spent last season coaching for Morehouse College. He had been with Coach Williams the first 3 years when Coach Williams took over as the OC, and then it was Andrico Hines was the offensive coordinator last year for that state championship team. Andrico Hines, now the head coach at Banneker High School. Man, Coach Williams, you know, you could hear him light up when he talked about Coach Hines getting that opportunity to go be a head coach at Berkmar. He felt like that was the first branch of his coaching tree. I'd say you got a pretty good resume when you go 15-0 win the state championship. So it'll be first and 10 from the Raider 24. Huge momentum play here going into the half. Less than 5 seconds left. Hughes with the football and leading by 6. East Paulding will get the ball to begin the third quarter. They won the toss and defer. Nolan backing up after one last adjustment to his offensive line. The snap. Nolan dropping back. Raiders send a blitz over the middle. Caught by Giovanni McGee for a touchdown. Streaking on the deep post route. Giovanni McGee with his third touchdown catch of the season. And a massive, massive swing as the clock is hit zeros. As Hughes will go into the locker room with a 2-score lead. Perfect throw from Nolan, and Shy McGee playing his first game since week one, August 18th. He's been out with injury. And now Hughes is lining up for the extra point here, ahead by 12, 33-21. And the kick from Cheers is good. And our halftime score, thanks to a 74-yard drive in less than 30 seconds for Langston Hughes, it is the Hughes Panthers, number 7 in the country, or state rather, number 7 in the GPB poll, the defending state champions. They lead East Paulding 34-21. We will take a moment to step aside during this 20-minute halftime. It's homecoming night here at East Paulding, but it's the Hughes Panthers who have a 2-score lead headed into the break. I'm Wiley Ballard. We appreciate you watching right here on GPB Sports. This is Football Fridays in Georgia, our webcast this evening.
In Cartersville, Bartow, 3 Smithsonian-affiliated museums, Barnsley Resort, and an authentic downtown full of unique restaurants and shops. The perfect destination for a memorable staycation, only in Cartersville, Bartow.
Cigna Healthcare is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna Healthcare's mission is to improve the health and vitality of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is all about Georgians standing together for substance misuse prevention. Be kind to your mind. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at GARedRibbon.org.
While we've got a quick break in the action, did you know that the same area of just one football field can contain up to 95 termite colonies? That's why you need Breda Pest Management to defend your home. Breda, the official pest control of high school football.
Graduation, she was planning on attending college to become a nurse in this country. She said she considers being nominated by her class as a blessing. Ava's most embarrassing moment was when she fell off her bike, knocking her front tooth out. She described success as when you set goals for yourself and achieve them no matter how big or small they are. Ava's most prized possession is her phone, because without it, she would be bored. And it helps her stay in contact with people she cares about. Ava is escorted tonight by her father, Roy. Kennedy is the daughter of Randy and John Donovan. She loves cooking and spends time with her family and friends, especially her sister, Lexi. During her high school, she hopes to maintain a 4.0 GPA and be a DECA officer. After graduation, Kennedy plans on attending college to become a nurse. Very honored and thankful to be nominated for homecoming award. Kennedy's most influential people in her life are her mom and grandma. They have taught her to be the best version of herself to allow her to follow her heart. She loves them both so very much. She wishes her grandma could have been here tonight. Kennedy's favorite motto is, spread love everywhere you go. Her favorite movie is The Notebook. Kennedy is escorted tonight by her father, John. Now representing the sophomore class, Miss Eva Burke. Eva is going to soccer, football, and healthcare. Before Eva graduates, she wants to be a better version of herself mentally and physically. After graduation, she hopes to play soccer at the college collegiate level. She's extremely honored that her peers nominated her, and it is truly special to be on court with her sister again in her senior year. Eva said her most embarrassing moment was tumbling down the stairs in front of everyone her freshman year. Eva's most influential person in her life is her club coach, Daniel, because she is smart and kind, helped her become the best version of herself. Her favorite motto is, "Fear not, I'm with you," Isaiah 41:10. Eva tonight is being escorted by her uncle, Nestor. Miss Ashlyn Brooks. My friends are Autumn and Nicole Brooks and Michael Brooks, and stepdaughter to Casey Brooks. She is a varsity cheerleader and loves tumbling and snowboarding. Ashlyn said it means so much to her to be nominated to represent the sophomore class, and is so grateful for the opportunity. In the future, she would like the opportunity to cheer at the Chick-fil-A Beach Bowl at the University of Georgia. After graduation, Ashlyn plans on attending college to get a degree in criminal geography. She thinks success is not the key to happiness, but happiness is the key to success. If you love and enjoy what you're doing, you will be successful. Ashley's favorite motto is, "Everything happens for a reason." Her favorite movie is Forever My Girl. Ashley's being escorted tonight by her father, Michael. Miss Shelby Dutton. Shelby is the daughter of Jerry and Doug Dutton. She enjoys being part of the varsity cheer, Deca, Beta, Tulsa, and Best Buddies.
being nominated again for homecoming for sport means so much to her. She is truly blessed and thankful to the class of 2026 for this opportunity. While at East, she hopes to continue to show and share God's love to everyone. After graduation, Shelby plans on attending college to become a nurse. She believes the meaning of success is to accomplish desired visions and planned goals. Even accomplishing something small can be something bigger in life. Shelby's favorite motto is, you can change your wish to see the world. Her favorite movie is The Light. Shelby's being escorted tonight by her father, Doug. Now representing the junior class, Miss Alina Chastain. Alina is the daughter of Caleb and Alejandro Sotomayor and Ronnie Payne. She is a varsity cheerleader, loves staying active, and hanging out with friends and family. Before graduating, her goal is to get a 4.0 GPA and be involved in as many high school activities and experiences as she can. After graduation, she wants to attend UGA and become a nurse. Alina said that it's an honor and privilege to be nominated for homecoming court. She feels special and grateful being chosen by her peers. The most influential person in her life is her mother, because she has been there and supported her through life's troubles. She has never given up on her, even when Alina had given up on herself. She would not be here without her love and support. Alina's favorite movie is Rapunzel. She's being escorted tonight by her stepfather, Alejandro, being met on her on the field by her father, Ryan. Miss Lana honors the daughter of Rebecca and Jeffrey Mason. She loves marching band, swimming, and art. Before graduating, her goal is to become part of the student government. After graduation, she wants to attend out-of-state college to study animal medicine. Lana said she appreciates the nomination for homecoming court and is glad she made a positive impact on her peers. She said her most influential person in her life is her mother, because she has gone through so much that she has never failed to make her happy and give her everything she wants and needs. Lana's favorite movie is Frozen, but you can watch any Disney movie on repeat. Lana is escorted tonight by her father, Jeffrey. She is a DECA officer and is on the cross country and track team. Her goal before graduation is to become a DECA president. After graduation, she plans on attending college and getting a marketing degree. She said it is a great honor to be nominated for homecoming court for the junior class, and will always be a memorable moment for her. Maybe said success to her is putting your mind to something and achieving it. Maybe's most influential person in her life are her mother and sister, because she looks to them for guidance, support, in her life, and they are the most important women in her life. Her favorite motto is live simply, love deeply, care genuinely, and speak kindly. Mamie is escorted tonight by her father, Jeff. And now representing the senior class, Miss Ramoni Abrams. Ramoni is the daughter of Reverend and Lisa Abrams and Elizabeth Williams. She enjoys singing, dancing, and painting. Before graduating, her goal is to achieve leadership skills and help others become successful and strong. Ramoni feels honored and grateful to be joined by her peers to represent the senior class. After graduation, she wants to start off as a reserve and work in the medical field in the military. Her most embarrassing moment was in pre-K adventure, where she tried to steal a baby duck from the lake and put it in her book bag. And then she started crying when her mom told her she just could not take the baby back home. Ramoni said her success is what you make it and how you make it. It's not about what others want you to do. It is what you work hard on and what you want in life and how you never back down no matter how hard it gets. Because life is short and you have to strive for success and greatness to be whatever you desire. Her favorite mottos are, I live my life a quarter mile at a time and I don't have friends. Ramoni is escorted tonight by her father, Reginald, and being met on the field by her mother, Elizabeth, and stepmother, Lisa. Miss Allen Beavers. Allen is the daughter of Sandra and Tony Adams, Donna and Susan Beavers. She is a varsity sideline cheer captain and plays varsity lacrosse. She loves hanging out with her best friends and sisters and
going to Tim Kirk. Allen feels honored to be nominated by his peers. He's a world champion of representation of the class. After graduation, she plans on attending a four-year college while cheering at the collegiate level and majoring in early childhood education. Allen says success is setting goals for yourself and working hard for yourself as a nation. She feels that success is about progress, learning from your mistakes, studying what you have accomplished. Her most influential people in her life are her mother and father. They both have shaped her into the person she is today. They have no clue how much of an impact they have both made on her. They are her biggest supporters, and they mean the absolute world to her. Allen's favorite motto is, faith over fear, mind over matter. Allen is escorted tonight by her father, John, and led on the field by her mother, Tommy. Miss Addie Bennett. She enjoys listening to True Crime podcasts while being productive. Before she graduates, Addie would like to make the most of her senior year by living in the moment and making her final decision on where to go to college. After graduation, she would like to attend a four-year university and major in nursing. Addie is honored and grateful for the nomination to represent the senior class. The most influential person in her life is her father because they are both strong-willed and he wants the best for her. He pushes her to be the best person she can be and shows her what it means to be a child of God. Addie's favorite motto, stand firm and love well. Her favorite movie is the Harry Potter movie. Addie's being escorted tonight by her father, Paul, and is being led on the field by her mother, Sarah. Miss Sophia Burke. Sophia is the daughter of Ben and William De Jesus. She enjoys competing in Delta and HOSA, being a HOSA officer, and going to the gym. For graduation, she wants to get her real estate license and be accepted to the University of Alabama. After graduation, she plans on starting a real estate company over the summer, either in nursing school or planning to become a plastic surgeon. Sophia says that she is honored for being nominated for the 4 year as well, and it's so special to share this experience with her sister, being on the board as well. This is truly a heartwarming experience for her. She describes success as being able to give back to her parents for everything they have provided for the past 18 years. Sophia says that she has been blessed with the best role models growing up, including her parents, Atlanta and Pop Pop, along with her abuela, who all are here tonight supporting her. Her most prized possession is her rose gold Ford Mustang. Sophia is escorted tonight by her father, Frank, being led on the field by her mother, Lily. Hey, hey, hey. Miss Melanie Penelope. Melanie is the daughter of Emma and Hugo Espinoza. She enjoys playing soccer for club YMCA and EPHS, and she is in the JROTC. Melanie enjoys going to concerts, going to the gym, and spending time with her family. Before she graduates, she would like to make a positive difference in the lives of others by donating her time and talents with community service projects. After graduation, she plans on joining the Navy and becoming a combat medic for 4 years. Then she plans on attending the Airline Academy and getting her flight attendant license to travel the world. Melanie has dreamed of being on homecoming court her senior year. She is over the top excited to represent the senior class. It feels like she has made a positive impression on her peers, and she is very grateful for this opportunity. Melanie's most influential person in her life is her mother because she is an amazing example of how to work hard and how to love. She loves her to the moon and back. Her favorite motto, when you look good, you feel good, and when you feel good, you do good. When you do good, you succeed. Her most prized possession is her Mexican heritage. Melanie is being escorted tonight by her father, Hugo, and is being met on the field by her mother, Anna. Near the front line, each grade level princess and the senior queen is the 2022 NPHS homecoming queen, Miss Sophia Malioni. She is pursuing acting and working with her agent to book commercials. She loves her plants and her sweet Scotty. Sophia is very honored to be here tonight to crown the 2023 homecoming princesses and queens. Sophia is escorted tonight by the 2022 EPHS
alumni Scott Wilson will be met on the field by EPHS principal Mr. Brad Thomas. And now the 2023 East Paulding High School freshman princess is Madeline Gilbert. Sophomore princess is Eva Burns. High School junior princess is Mamie Jeffrey. Thank you.
Well, welcome back to the Boneyard. East Paulding High School, Raider Stadium. The number 7 Hughes Panthers lead East Paulding 34-21. As we get ready for the second half. And in case you're just joining us, we can run through some scoring recap. The first quarter, opening drive of the game for Hughes, which began at the 50 because East Paulding failed to recover an onside kick. It was a 50-yard drive, 7 carries, all for Justice Savage. His last was a 1-yard rush for the first touchdown. Made it 7-0 Hughes, and that was our score going into the second quarter, believe it or not. That's when things really went a little haywire offensively. It was a 61-yard touchdown scramble for Chance Booknight, the quarterback for East Paulding, that knotted us at 7-7. Then about 2 minutes later, it was Justice Savage again, punching it in from 1 yard out. That made it 13-7. Now, East Paulding responded again. It was a huge, huge run from Javen Parker that got them into position. Or beg your pardon, it was actually Jamon Harris making that big catch as a bit of a trick play as he subbed in at the last moment, hopping from the sideline right to the edge of the field. He set up Javen Parker, who got in for a touchdown with the extra point. That gave East Paulding the lead 14-13. But then the Panthers went on a 21-0, or rather, two-score run. Afterwards, 3rd-and-24 from the 23, or beg your pardon, 3rd-and-23 from the 24. It was Aaron Nolan, number 4 quarterback in the country. He rushed for 24 yards for a touchdown with 4.5 minutes left. That made it 19-14, East Paulding. And this is when disaster struck for East Paulding. Hughes with the lead. Disaster struck for East Paulding when they muffed a kick, and that led to another quick score for Hughes. It was a touchdown pass from Aaron Nolan to Dejon Gibson. That made it 27-14 thanks to a two-point conversion from Jabari Jones. So with 4.5 minutes left or thereabouts, East Paulding trailing by 2 scores, and they went down the field, got a huge 4th-and-2 conversion. That was a 32-yard run down to the Hughes 10-yard line from Raider running back Javen Parker. They went on to score. It was a terrific pass from Booknight to Cameron Shelley in the far corner of the end zone. And that made it 27-21, 30 seconds left. And that's where Hughes got real surgical. They managed both the time and the field brilliantly. Using a couple of timeouts, they got themselves a shot from just inside the Raider 25-yard line with 4 seconds left. And it was a strike on a post route from Aaron Nolan to Giovanni McGee, making it 34-21. So that's our scoring recap. And now it is time to go. Now, East Paulding deferred their choice to the second half, so they will receive this second half kickoff from Ezekiel Cheers. The two returners for the Raiders, Jamarco Ford on the far side, Eddie Ferguson on the near side. Second half action, East Paulding, joined by a couple of scores to the number 7 Hughes Panthers. And here we go, and this is a little pooch kick fielded by the up back. And they were going right back to Cameron Jones. He muffed a similar kick. That time he called for a fair catch. And he makes the catch at the 34-yard line. So 2 lead changes so far today. And Hughes, 2-1 in Region 5 in Class 6A. They lost to Douglas County, who's 3-0 in Region 5. Meanwhile, East Paulding also 3-0, but they played a lot of the teams in the bottom half of the standings. This is an 8-team region this year in 2023-24. All right, so a 4 wide receiver set, trips right. Javen Parker, their bell cow in the backfield. And they'll give it right to him as he goes off the right tackle, bounces through 1 tackle, tries to redirect, and he is wrangled in the backfield for a huge loss. That time Josiah Marsh, or I beg your pardon, that was Bo Jacobs, the linebacker for Hughes, making that big tackle for loss. It's a loss of 6 back to the 29, 2nd-and-16. Booknight calls for the snap. He's dropping the pass. floats it over the middle, a little too tall for Cameron Shelley. And that time.
Brings up second down. Correction, brings up third down.
It was Terrence Brown in coverage for Hughes. Third down and 16. Boy, a three and out to start. Hardy leading by two scores would be huge for Hughes. Booknight. Pocket collapses. Breaks through a would-be tackler. Trying to dance around the second level. And he's forced out of bounds. That time by Jacob Good, who had an interception in the first half. And Booknight gets back to the original line of scrimmage, but on fourth and 10, it'll be a three and out. And this will be our first punt of this game. Jonathan Castillo, the junior, on to kick it away. Back deep for Hughes is Jabari Jones. Second all-time meeting between these two teams. This one much different than what we saw last year when Hughes won 59-0. And Castillo's punt will bounce just inside the 30.
Jonathan Castillo punt goes out of bounds to
And this will be about a 36, maybe 37-yard punt. They're going to put it to 28. So 37-yard punt from Castillo. And now Hughes with 11 minutes and 3 seconds still left in this third quarter. They got a chance to really step on top of the Raiders here. East Paulding needs a stop desperately. Hughes had the football 6 times in the first half. They scored 5 touchdowns. The only time they didn't score was when they turned the ball over on downs at the Raider 5. First and 10, ball at 28. Nolan gives to Savage. Left side, he's met behind the line of scrimmage, or right at it at least. Emery Giles there on the stop, number 30 for the Raiders. That'll be a no gain, second and 10. Given the line of scrimmage on forward progress. Quarterback for the Panthers, Aaron Nolan, wearing number 1, committed to Ohio State. He's thrown for over 4,000 yards in his career. Over 9,000 yards in his career, over 4,000 last year. And they said Gibson in motion across the line. Nolan, the lefty, under pressure, dumps it off, and the pass a little tall. And while Savage was able to reel it in, that was Dorian Page making that catch. He brought it in. But he was so off balance that he toppled to the ground afterwards. Big moment here. Raider defense was so close to getting into the locker room down by 6. They could not keep Hughes out of the end zone on the final play of the first half. Now they've got a chance to force a 3-and-out of their own after the Raider offense couldn't pick up a first down. Trips bunched up to the right. Nolan, 5-step drop. Cuts it loose, looking for Gibson on the deep ball. What a throw! Gibson reels it in, and it's an absolute rainbow from Aaron Nolan. My goodness, there are just not many players at this level that can do that. In stride, not only was it terrific arm strength, but what touch. That was a 50-yard gain. 50-yard pass there from Nolan to Gibson, who's having the best night of his season, by the way, Deshaun Gibson. Around the right side, Page redirects. Now Nolan lays a block on Leader. That's going to be a first down inside the 10. Inside the 5, in fact, from Dorian Page. And, man, you got to marvel at Aaron Nolan right here. Prentice Nolan One play earlier, he drops a 50-yard dime, and this time he lays a block on Jeremy Leader. They will spot it at the 2-yard line, so a 20-yard rush for Trey Page. And they give it to Page. Is he into the end zone? Yes, he is. Touchdown, Hughes. And it's a 3-score game. And that right there, that back-to-back play sequence. Nolan, a 50-yard dime, and then lays a difference-making block against Jeremy Leader to spring Page for a 20-yard gain. Page punches or finishes it out with a 2-yard rush, and we're going to have a flag here blowing the play dead. Kick was good that time from Cheeks. Be offsides against East Paulding. Now, an extra point here puts Hughes up by 20. I suppose they'd be justified in trying to go for two here, make it an even 3-touchdown game. But Cheeks is still lined up for the field goal here. PAT attempt, rather. Good snap, and the kick is blocked. That's a dead ball. I believe, yes, Wayne Lucas is the Raider who got his hand on the football, so that keeps 1 point off the board, but it's the largest lead of the night for Hughes as they win the battle the first 4 minutes of the second half, leading 40-21. Coach Williams told us earlier this week he was really hoping to see the team that beat Carrollton 7 weeks ago on the road, giving Carrollton and the Trojans their first loss at home in 4 years. But they lost some of their mojo with all those injuries, losing guys like Giovanni McGee, who scored a touchdown tonight, DeMarcus Brown on the defensive side. Still without JoJo Stone, another key receiver piece for them. Looks like Hughes got a little bit of their moxie back here. Leading big here on the road against East Paulding. A team that is going to be in the conversation for most improved teams from last year to this. They went 3-7 overall and 1-6 in region play last year. They've already won more games this year than all of last season. And this kick fielded by Ferguson just inside the 25. He'll try and take it back towards the middle of the field. Moves north and south, and he's stopped at the 37-yard line. Sledge with the tackle for Hughes. At least Paulding did a fine job of responding after they got down 2 scores. With a methodical 4-minute drive to cut it to 6 just before the half. Now they're down 3 scores. Well, there's plenty of football left. They've got to show a little bit of life here offensively, a little bit of a punch back. See the right guard. Tristan Zuniga trying to bounce up and down pre-snap, trying to get his team fired up as they pitch it out to Parker. He's knocked out of bounds. Jordan Thompson, the first man there. Jordan Thompson wearing number 6 for Hughes. Tore his ACL in the second round of the playoffs last year. came back fully healthy this year. The number 57, he's the near side edge rusher for Hughes. That's DeMarcus Brown playing his first game since the state final last year. A little dart over the middle, caught by Shelley. And he spins nearly out of a tackle. Santonio Jones got just enough of him. But that is a big-time play there from Cameron Shelley to reel in what was a perfect pass from Chance Booknight. First and 10 at the 41-yard line now for East Paulding. 7.5 left in the third quarter. Little pop pass to Jamon Harris. He has one big play today, looking for another. A little jitterbug, and he is table-topped. Right at the 31-yard line, it appears. Be enough for a first down, a gain of 10. That was a pretty serious lick he took. And he's listed at just 116 pounds. He can fly. So first and 10, ball at the 31 now. Still plenty of time left in this football game for East Paulding to make a run at it. They give it to Parker. Bounces outside. The first hole was plugged, and so's the second. And again, that time, Bo Jacobs, and a couple of big tackles so far in the second half. Brian Allen motioning. He'll line up as the middle receiver in that trip side on the left. Haven't called his name too often tonight. Coach Hirschfield says he's their best all-around player. Booknight has it batted down at the line. I'm not sure who got the paw on it. Alonzo Jackson swatted it away. Third down and 11. East Paulding's got to find a way to get on the board here. They want to keep within shouting distance. As Hughes has begun to separate up by 19. They go to Parker. Up the gut. He gains about a yard. That's it. Fourth down and 10. And it looks like the Raiders are going to go for a field goal here. This is going to be Landon Schaefer on to kick it. Now it's a 19-point game, so if Schaefer can make this field goal, which is going to be about a 47-yarder, that's well within his range, this would make it a two-score game. Baylor Thomas in the holder. Carson Griffith, the long snapper. Low snap. Schaefer gets it off. Does it have enough leg? No, it does not. Short. And a little bit of something-something. As Justin Bonds, I think, lost his helmet there for Hughes trying to get after that kick. That 47-yard attempt is short. I just don't think Schaefer got all of it. That simple. Did a 54-yarder earlier this year. He's now 5-for-8 on the season after that miss. So for East Paulding, they do flip the field. High school rules. Hughes will take over on their own 20 after the missed field goal. But down by 19, 5.5 minutes left to go in the third quarter. I don't think Hughes is a team that's going to think about trying to kill time as much as they'll just continue to run their offense. They do like to rush the football. Nolan, play action. Pass complete on the screen off to the left. Catch made by Austin Antonio Sledge, rather. It's a modest gain, about 2 yards. Five minutes left, third quarter. 2-by-2 receiver. Handoff between the tackles. Oh, how about that secondary push from the Hughes offensive line? Helping out Trey Page. Bites off 6 yards on that rush. Third down and 2. Jamarco Ford subbing back in for East Paulding. Quick snap. Hand off to Page. He's got the first. Still on his feet. And the Raiders gang up on him. First Raider on the scene was Trayvon French. Needed just 2. He got 6 again. First and 10 for 34. Chris Stokes checking back in, replacing Caleb Funches. Stokes, 94 in black, committed to Marshall. Looking to go play for the Thundering Herd next year. Javonnie McGee in motion. Nolan to Justice Savage. Lowers his head, tries to pick up some speed. He goes down on first contact just beyond the 35-yard line.
Brought down by number 15,
Brody Burge. In on the stop for East Paulding. Looks like it's a gain of 3, which makes it second and 7 here. Ball at 36. 3.5 minutes to play, third quarter. Hughes to the air on the slant. It is incomplete.
Pass attempt for number 83, Khalil Allen.
Looking for Khalil Allen there on that pass attempt. Lost his footing, couldn't hang on to the football. Well, it's not raining now, and it stopped raining about late in the second quarter. It was a pretty consistent off and on drizzle during the game and then just a flat out drizzle the hour before. So that field is slick. After the incompletion, third down and 7. Got to get to the 43-yard line for the Panthers. Nolan looking. He's found an open man in the soft spot of the defense. And it is a catch. They're ruling it as a catch. Coach Hirschfield is adamant on his sideline, saying that ball was not caught by Javonnie McGee. But it is ruled a completion. I couldn't tell from up here. Marius Whitaker on the tackle, and he's also needed some attention. So he gets a look from the trainer. That also gives Coach Hirschfield an opportunity to come onto the field here and plead his case about that being a dropped pass. And he gets on the ground, and you can see him there at the white top saying, "You see me? Just like I'm the ball. I'm on the ground." And he has given the officiating crew an earful. Disgusted with the call. Hopefully Demarius Whitaker is okay. Coach Hirschfield in the second season continuing. Back out onto the field. Pleading with the officials. You're just not going to get that overturned. Maybe there'll be a little bit of discussion here, but I'd be surprised if they change the call at this point. To be fair, I'm not sure any of the officials got a great look at it. The view was obstructed by both those Raiders surrounding McGee, and McGee kind of went into a crouch to make the catch, seemingly. So if he caught it, it was still really close to the ground. Trying to get a look at Whitaker. Looks like he's going to have to be helped off the field here. Favoring that right leg, he is waddling off. I guess he's under his own power, but certainly not 100%. So after the catch by McGee, it's first and 10. It was third down and 7 clock back winding now. Xavier Tiller, tight end, shuffles over to the left. And it's Page around left end. Bounces off one tackler, surges upfield, down the sideline. He's got the first. What a burst. Trey Page. He just needs a little sliver. They strung him out. And he saw the alley between the sideline and the numbers, and he jetted forward. That'll move the chains again. 17-yard gain. First and 10, Hughes. And they're on the verge of putting this one just about all the way out of reach. Raiders need a turnover. They haven't gotten one today. High snap. Nolan leaps in the air, comes back down, hands it off to Page. Flag comes flying in from the backside of the play. At the moment, it's a gain of three. This signal is going to be holding against Hughes. Our official, Trevor Gonzalez, says yes, it is holding. Gonzalez in his ninth year as an official with GHSA. That's not surprising. There are plenty of experienced officials around the state. What is surprising is Gonzalez has those 24 years of experience, or rather 24 years old. I kind of butchered that, didn't I? 9 years as an official. He's only 24 years old. He started officiating at 15. His father, Jody Gonzalez, was an official. He started as a ninth grader trying to make some money. Handoff up the middle. And it's just a Savage.
21 Savage on the carry.
Who slices his way to the 35. You know, we got to give the public address announcer a little love here. He is announcing Justice Savage as 21 Savage. I'm sure he loves that. Second down and 11 after a 4 yard gain, or 9 yard gain, rather. And that pass incomplete intended for McGee, but a flag comes flying out from the very near the end zone. This looks like it's in the area of pass interference. Maybe defensive holding. Roy is making Trevor Gonzalez, 24 years old, started officiating at age 15. And that will be defensive pass interference there on East Paulding. He started as a high school student just looking for some extra cash, but, you know, he's now got a full-time job. He says he would have missed the Friday Night Light thrills too much. He really gained an appreciation for it as the years went by. He gets some butterflies as he gets ready to begin on a Friday night. So after the pass interference call, 15-yard penalty will be first and 10 from the 19. Hughes is in the red zone again. They've scored 6 touchdowns tonight on 7 possessions. Savage around the left side. 15. He's tripped up.
21 Savage on the field.
Another healthy gain. I think it was Norvis Martinez. Yes, Martinez on the stop. Ball will be spotted at the 13. It's a gain of 6. Second and 4. Minute and 10 seconds left in this third quarter. Hughes not in a rush. Happy to kill some clock here. And looks like a false start against the Panthers. So I'll back him up, making it second and 9 from the 18.
Six
We talked about those injuries for Hughes. We also failed to mention Maurice Gleaton, one of their fastest receivers. He's still out, and so is Nakari Johnson, the key defensive piece. So Hughes, again, has been clobbered by the injury bug. They did drop that region game against Douglas County, but positioned to pick up their third region win of the year, improved to 3-1, and in second place in the region. Little jump ball out to Xavier Tiller. Did he make that catch? You bet he did. His first catch of the night's a touchdown. His fourth of the season. And they've all come in the last four games. 18-yard snag from Xavier Tiller. Oh, but there's a flag on the play. I beg your pardon, a late flag. So that will not be a touchdown. Ball moved back to the 23-yard line. I don't know what the call was there. I missed it. Looked like a legal man downfield. An eligible receiver. And this pass is complete to Justice Savage. He lunges forward, soars across the 10-yard line. Another flag comes out. So an eligible receiver was the last call. Let's see what this one is. And it's going to be holding against Hughes. So 12 seconds left in the third quarter. And because it's a spot foul, it essentially results in a no play. It was a gain of 10, and then a 10-yard penalty backs him up to the 23, and that's going to end the third quarter. Hughes expands their lead to 19, and they're on the verge to making this a four-score game. Panthers are looking a lot like the team that beat Carrollton in week one 7 weeks ago, starting to find their stride, and you know Coach Williams has got to be satisfied. And for East Paulding, you know, I don't think Coach Hirschfield's all that interested in moral victories. He said one of the keys tonight was getting the game to the fourth quarter, and they were close to doing that. That touchdown at the end of the second half that turned a six-point deficit into a 13-point deficit really hurt the Raiders, gave Hughes all the momentum going into the locker room.
Cartersville Bartow, three Smithsonian-affiliated museums, Barnsley Resort, and an authentic downtown full of unique restaurants and shops. The perfect destination for a memorable staycation, only in Cartersville Bartow.
Cigna Healthcare is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna Healthcare's mission is to improve the health and vitality of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is all about Georgians standing together for substance misuse prevention. Be kind to your mind. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
While we've got a quick break in the action, did you know that the same area of just one football field can contain up to 95 termite colonies? That's why you need Breda Pest Management to defend your home. Breda, the official pest control of high school football.
Such a variety of penalties here. It'll be third down at about 14. They got to get to the 9-yard line. Two receivers to the right, McGee and Gibson. And they're looking for Giovanni McGee, and he's got his second touchdown pass of the night. And it is 46-21. Langston Hughes has blown it wide open, but a flag is out. Now, was it after the play? Was it excessive celebration? Doesn't look like it's coming back. I think maybe after the play, and we've also got an injury here too. Looks like I believe that's an injured Raider that is down. He is moving. Yeah, so it was after the play and the penalty. I'm assuming excessive celebration and unsportsmanlike conduct will be assessed on the kickoff, we're told. And now this is Jameel Jones, defensive back for the Raiders, who is walking off the field under his own power, but that's now the second corner that's gone down due to injury for the Raiders. The other, Demarius Whitaker. Looks like we're about to get things going again. We talked about the improvement for East Paulding from year one to year two, and you can look over at the other sideline, Langston Hughes, they had a similar turnaround from year one to year two under Coach Williams. They went 2-8 in that first year. Coach Williams said he was like a college freshman trying to sign up for everything, doing too much. Then the second year, they got to their first ever quarterfinal in school history. The next year, it got to their first ever state final. And then last year, year four under Williams, won their first ever state championship. As the kick is up and through. And that makes it 47-21 after the extra point from Ezekiel Cheeks. So a 26-point lead. Now the Raiders, at this point, they not only need to score, but they need to score fast. And they have yet to score in this second half. Taking some time here, getting play back up and running. Hughes will be forced to kick this one off from the 25-yard line. It's a 15-yard penalty. Cheers is placing his tee down at the 30. So the Raiders ought to get some pretty good field position. And the kick is a short one. Look alive. This is a live ball. Did it go out of bounds or was it recovered by Hughes? I thought it touched a Raider. It'll be first down for somebody here. And there's some discussion here from Trevor Gonzalez. These Paulding offenses heading back onto the field. They look pretty confident it's going to be Raider football. The chains, though, are set up in the direction of Hughes, but there's a penalty on Langston Hughes. The chains are not in the right spot. We're going to have to figure this one out here. So it's some type of illegal procedure on the Panthers. First down, and I think it is Raider football. They're not going to ask Hughes to re-kick it, so it must have been Raider football anyway. Coach Williams asking for an explanation on his end exactly to what the call was. I'm almost wondering if he feels like, well, we should be able to re-kick it if they wound up with possession. Hang on now, hang on. Officials time out. They got to talk this one over. I'm not convinced that Hughes didn't recover that kick. Now both teams are going to have to huddle here. Okay. Well, our head official, Trevor Gonzalez, is going to have to sort this out. He's currently in the East Paulding huddle, so he's delivering some kind of news to Coach Hirschfield. All right, so he's told Coach Hirschfield the story, and now head back to midfield and gather up and hold a conference with the rest of his officiating crew. It's still the defense on the field for Hughes, and it's still the offense coming onto the field for East Paulding. They put the ball down at the Panther 49. All right, it looks like we're good. So no changes after that conference. So first and 10. 11:33 left to go. Fourth quarter. Cam Shelley in motion. Now he races back to the original side he was on, and Booknight rolls that way. He's looking for Shelley in and out of his hands. And I'm still not sure if he hauls it in, he would have been in bounds. Second and 10. Boy, Coach Hirschfield, he had so many great things to say about Cameron Shelley, who missed the last four games of the 2022 season due to a concussion. Had a season-high 165 yards in their win over Noonan last week, including two touchdown catches. He had just one catch all season last year. Second down and 10. And Booknight keeps it himself, and he is brought down behind the line. Welcome back, DeMarcus Brown. Man, has Langston Hughes missed you. Playing his first game since tearing his ACL in last year's state championship game in December. And Coach Williams was telling us all week long, he's been smiling, fired up, excited to get back on the field. I can promise you that one felt good for him. So it's a loss of two, third down and 12. Booknight, deep ball, looking for Allen. He can't make the catch. The helmet comes flying off. And Brian Allen, he has just been shut out tonight. Coming into tonight, he led the Raiders with touchdown catches. He was second on the team in receptions. He was a guy who played mostly on defense last year, but they needed him on offense more this year, so he plays instead sparingly on defense and much more on offense this year. And he and Booknight just have not been able to find their connection. They ruled that a complete catch? Wow. They're saying it was a completed pass. Well, we saw one call that went Hughes' way on a big third down. Now one goes the Raiders' way. Not much objection from Hughes, so maybe I just saw it wrong and the officials did too at first glance. The give is to Eddie Ferguson. Going around the left side, he falls forward down to the 9. And a healthy gain on first and 10 from the 14. That makes it 2nd and 5. A little bit of life maybe for East Paulding, but they still trail by 4 scores. 10 minutes, 20 seconds left in the fourth quarter. Looking for their first points of the second half. They've had a 3 and out and missed field goal so far. And it's Ferguson again. And Amir Glenn, the first man to devour him behind the line. Future Wake Forest Demon Deacon. Third down and a long 6, a loss of 1. Got to get to the 4. And some movement up front. I think Glenn jumped. Yeah, he had a taste of that tackle for loss flavor, and he wanted another helping. A little too eager. That ought to make it 3rd and short. I got to think this is, again, 2-down territory. Look, the odds are slim right now for East Paulding, trailing by 26, but still trying to get on the board here in the second half. And who knows, get some momentum. Play action to Ferguson. Now they go deep, looking for Allen, and a flag comes flying out. They're going to get Torrey Arnold for pass interference there. It'll be 1st and goal, half the distance to the goal line. How to put the ball around the 2.5-yard line. 1st and goal, Raiders. And a handoff, right side, right near the goal line. They will mark him short, though. Eddie Ferguson could not get in. Second string halfback had just 3 carries for 2 yards last week. His only other touchdown this year came against Woodland in week 1, August 18th. And we've got a timeout, Hughes. I think for Coach Williams, this is, if nothing else, just a chance to work on some situational football. They've got this game well in hand. We appreciate you joining us here on our GPB webcast, our web game, part of Football Fridays in Georgia. I want to thank our crew as well. We've got Reagan Smith working our scorebug. We've got our head engineer and producer, Nathan Sims, and the best cameraman in the state, Shane Williams, helping us out. He's blushing right now, ladies and gentlemen. You know, for a moment there, we thought Shane was going to get the best of us because he had that raincoat. The rest of us were sitting here with up a creek without a paddle, if you will. But it's all right. The rain stopped. We knew it would. Look at that. Shane's getting us back to the action. The timeout is over. So this is 2nd and goal from inside the 1. Go, go, go. Book Knight and shotgun. A late sub comes in. This is Gil Nkrumah. Eddie Ferguson, the halfback's done some heavy lifting on this drive. They give him a chance to finish it off. Oh, we got pre-snap movement, and looks like this is going to be on the Raiders. Wow. Inside the one, a false start. It's now second and goal from the five. Crowd hasn't thinned too much. Got to give Raiders fans credit here. Homecoming. We had the homecoming court announced. The King announced prior to the game. The Queen announced at halftime. Second goal from the five. They feed Ferguson. And he is swarmed behind the line. Another flag comes out, though.
There's a penalty marking on the field.
This officiating crew's been busy these last few minutes. Oh, a chop block against East Paulding. They went from second and goal inside the one, and they're going to be backed way up here on the chop block. Going all the way back to the 20-yard line. And they were inside the 1 second and goal. Now it's second and goal from the 20. And Hughes defensive coordinator Ben Arnold has been at Hughes for over the last 10 years in one capacity or another. His defense still has a chance to pitch that second half shutout. Book Knight dealing with a blitz. Hoists it high in the air. Looking for Jones. And he's into the end zone. Touchdown, Cameron Jones. And that second half shutout is gone for Jones. That's his fourth touchdown of the season. And the sixth of his Raider career. Well, if nothing else, backing up 20 yards, that will expand the field of play a little bit. And good poise by Book Knight. If the game out of reach here, there's probably a little smack talk going back and forth, a little jabbering from both sides. Gonzalez getting clarification on the call. And for East Paulding, this makes their next game 2 weeks from now against Douglas County very interesting. And it's going to be holding against Hughes. If it had been a lesser game, Coach Hirschfeld might consider declining that penalty for just trying to get the ball back. But again, this one feels like it's pretty close to out of reach, down by 3 scores, 5.5 minutes left, barring a turnover. Again, Hughes has not punted all night. They have scored 7 touchdowns on 8 possessions. The only time they didn't score was a turnover on downs. That was inside the 10. Clock winds. Ball spotted at the 8. That makes it first down and a short 15, if you will, if there is such a thing. Handoff. It's Brown again. This time he goes between the tackles. And a mass of humanity there being pushed across the 10. They'll spot it at the 12. And that's a gain of 4. Second and 11. Under 5 minutes to play now. But as we were talking, I mean, you look at the way things are shaping up here in Region 5 with Hughes getting this road win over East Paulding. Douglas County got a road win over Hughes. And if East Paulding gets a road win over Douglas County in 2 weeks, then all of a sudden you look at a strong possibility of a three-way tie. And I'm not familiar with the tie-breaking procedures in Region 5 Class 6A, but that can make things interesting. And Brown redirects, and he's going to flip the field on him. He's got Nolan as his lead blocker racing around the right side, and Brown knocked out of bounds. Or was that Justice Savage? No, Brown. It was Brown. Out to the 40-yard line. How about Terquavius Brown? Picks up 27 yards, and, you know, Aaron Nolan, he fell on his backside at the end of that play, almost like it might have been a mistake or something, but he fell down, and then once he saw Brown flip the field, you know, Nolan, who I think went down in more of an exaggerated fashion, he raced back up and said, all right, I got a block from my fellow senior here. And we got a timeout on the field called by East Paulding. Under 4 minutes to play, trailing by 18 points. Coach Hirschfeld might be preaching composure and poise here and making sure nothing gets out of hand. It's been a pretty long game, though. We kicked this thing off at 7:30. We're closing in on the 2 hour and 40 minute mark. And a lot of penalties in the fourth quarter. And they've been some confusing ones, too. It's required some officials' timeouts to talk things over. But again, if Douglas County, East Paulding, and Hughes all finish with one loss, that would be East Paulding beating Douglas County on the road in 2 weeks. You could have a three-way tie, and that's also assuming that New Manchester, Noonan, Paulding County, and South Paulding, the teams at the middle, the bottom part of the standings and Region 5 don't jump up and bite somebody, but you could have a three-way tie. And one team could end up being on the road despite just having one region loss. All right, so 3 minutes, 52 seconds after the timeout from the Raiders. First and 10, Langston Hughes. Defending state champs. I'm not going to say it's the cleanest game they can play, but they have found some things tonight. A little pop pass to Gibson around the left side, and he's brought down at the knees by Norvis Martinez. Still going hard, and There is a little something extra going on away from the play. That looked like it was Caleb Young. And maybe
if you find a green iPhone 12 with a green case and flowers on the back, please bring it to the
Jaden Doyle. Guys who haven't gotten much playing time tonight, they were spatting there on the backside of the play. Deep down the field. We'll play fake. This is directs back to Jabari Jones, I believe. So Nolan's out of the game. Yep, it was Jabari Jones, and another timeout called by East Paulding. So after a modest gain there from Jones, it'll be third down, I believe about six. Looks like they're going to put this at the 43. The ball has not been placed yet. Oh, yes, it has at the 43 on the near hash. But East Paulding will have their three-game win streak snapped. This is their first loss since September 1st against Hiram. They've gotten off to that 3-0 start in region play. And Hughes will win back-to-back games for just the second time this year. They started 2-0, then dropped two of their next three. But I think Hughes can be happy with getting Giovanni McGee back, his first game since going down with injury in the first game of the season. DeMarcus Brown had a nice tackle for loss, two big returning pieces for Hughes. And for East Paulding, look, 47-29, it may not have been a barn burner, but it was much closer than the 59-0 loss they suffered against Hughes last year, so they've made some progress as well. This handoff goes to Carson Baker, and he races ahead inside the 45 for a first down. That will be first and 10 after a gain of 13. This is Jabari Jones in here at quarterback. Looks like Aaron Nolan's night is done. Trying to kill a little more clock here. 15 seconds left on the play clock, under 2.5 minutes to play. Down to 10, and they snap it, and a little problem on the transfers. The ball is loose. I think Jones got back on top of it. Clock is still running, and yes, it is still Hughes football. Actually results in a gain of one. As Baker heads to the sideline, and it is second down and 9. And 2 minutes to play. I'll tell you what, one more first down and that'll officially do it. Ooh, nice move by Jones in the backfield. And he's got inside the 35. He's got the first down. He runs out of bounds, which may not have been the most advised move, but I suppose it beats taking a hit late in the football game that's already in hand. With a minute and 32 on the clock, only one timeout for East Paulding. Hughes ought to be able to knee this one out if they choose. So Hughes will improve to 5-2, 3-1 in region play. East Paulding will fall to 4-3 and also 3-1 in region play. Hand off up the middle. Travius Brown, not quite a kneel down, but a conservative play call. Timeout called by East Paulding here. They'll have to snap it two more times. before they can officially put this one in the books. Under a minute now. Jabari Jones waiting for the signal from the sideline. And the handoff this time goes to Baker. He races forward. He's into the end zone for an additional 6 points. Touchdown for Carson Baker. That is his first touchdown of the season. He's a sophomore, so I'd imagine that's the first touchdown of his career. So if you're wondering why Baker decided to score there, it is hard to blame a young man with a chance to score his first varsity touchdown. But that will stretch the lead now to 53-29. And it's another different Panther getting in the end zone. And for Hughes, that's the second consecutive week they've gotten over 50 points offensively. As the kick here from Cheers is a low-line drive, but it is good. 54-29 with 40 seconds left. And so you look at the final numbers here for Hughes. They got a touchdown from Justice Savage. In fact, two of them, the first two were from Savage. Then it was a touchdown rush from Aaron Nolan. And then at the horn, or I beg your pardon, it was a touchdown pass to Deshaun Gibson. That made it 27-14. They added their fifth touchdown of the first half on a play at the buzzer, a touchdown pass to Giovanni McGee. Then Trey Page scored a touchdown. He scored a second touchdown, and then Baker that time. So 8 touchdowns tonight scored by 6 different Panthers. Kickoff taken on the right side. 33 seconds left. Marco Ford took it. Again, plenty of positives for East Paulding, or rather for Langston Hughes, obviously. Scoring 50 points for the second consecutive week, doing so against a much more competitive team than Alexander last weekend when they won 56-0. And because of that, East Paulding has some positives too. I know they're not happy about the loss. This is the first time this year they've really been beaten handily. But this program has come a long way in 12 months. Long, long way. And now substitution questions and a timeout call by Hughes to avoid the infraction penalty. I think they're going to get either called for a legal substitution, too many men, or best case scenario, they weren't ready for the play. Scored 8 touchdowns, there are 9 possessions tonight, and that really is the story. You knew it was going to be tough to stop Langston Hughes, but when the Panthers got favorable field position multiple times, 50-yard line or better on 3 of their drives, and on top of that, they didn't turn the ball over at all, it was going to be a tough ride for the Raiders, who turned the ball over 3 times. 25 seconds left as
Shelley carries the ball up to the
Booknight completes that pass to Cam Shelley. Will East Paulding want to run another play here? That's the question. It's a gain of four, so second down and six. 8 seconds left. A whole lot of urgency trying to get this final play off. Three, two, they will snap it. Final play of the game here. Booknight takes a deep shot as the horn sounds, and in and out of the hands of Zach Hill. That would have been the fourth turnover of the night, but hardly a consequential one, as the Panthers improved to 3-1 in region play in class five or class six, region five. And the Raiders fall to 4-3 and 3-1 as well in region five. Well, we thank you so much for tuning in to our web game of the week here on Football Fridays in Georgia. It was our pleasure to bring it to you. We're excited to be back at it a week from tonight. But that will do it for us. A big thanks to our entire crew, our graphics operator, Reagan Smith, our producer slash engineer, Nathan Sims, our cameraman, Shane Williams. I'm Wiley Ballard saying so long and good night from the Boneyard. One more time, your final score, number 7, Langston Hughes, 54, East Paulding, 29. Thanks for joining us, and have a wonderful weekend.
Only in Cartersville, Bartow, three Smithsonian-affiliated museums, Barnsley Resort, and an authentic downtown full of unique restaurants and shops. The perfect destination for a memorable staycation, only in Cartersville, Bartow.
Cigna Healthcare is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna Healthcare's mission is to improve the health and vitality of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is all about Georgians standing together for substance misuse prevention. Be kind to your mind. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
While we've got a quick break in the action, did you know that the same area of just one football field can contain up to 95 termite colonies? That's why you need Breda Pest Management to defend your home. Breda, the official pest control of high school football.